Thank you, Brother Mike. I appreciate the opportunity to be here today. It's good to see you, and I'm honored to be here. I'll go ahead and give my disclaimer. About 8 o'clock last night, all the cold and the raspy voice started, so you may have to be patient with me this morning, but you all know all about that, don't you? Yes, you do. So, hey, but it is an honor to be here today, and certainly our prayers are with you as you seek God's face, as you seek a new pastor, that God would indeed lead you and that man to a very divine appointment. And we pray that God will lead you in all of that process. And also want to say this morning at BMA Global Missions, we're very thankful for your faithfulness to support missions around the world. You've always been very faithful, very generous, very committed. And so we thank you for that. I do want to give you just a couple of highlights of what's going on around the world in BMA Global Missions. I won't talk very long about that this morning before we get to the message. Of course, the first thing I want to talk to you about, I want to list to you three specific countries: China, Iran, Ukraine. Well, if you are adept and you are aware of some global happenings today, you know that all three of those countries have great turmoil right now for different reasons. China, of course, most recently, their people have been manifesting in the streets because of the very strict limitations on them during COVID, and they still have those strict limitations. Well, our missionaries there tell me that it looks like some of those manifestations are going to do some good, and our missionaries are very hopeful that there will be a new openness to be able to get out and do the things they need to do. And I will simply remind you, most people don't think about China and what I'm about to say. It is very possible that China is the most Christian nation on the planet. I'm going to say that again. It is very possible that China is the most Christian nation on the planet. And I'm talking about in sheer numbers of followers of Jesus. The gospel over the last 25 or 30 years in China has exploded. Many people have come to Christ, and a lot of people don't know that. But that is the truth. So when you hear about oppressive governments, I just challenge you to pray for the people. Because we don't always agree with our government, do we? No, we do not. And neither do they. And so just remember that. In Iran, recently they've also been manifesting because of their desire for freedom. Perhaps in an earlier visit I shared with you that a couple of years ago I was in a bordering country of Iran, and I was there to teach house church leaders from Iran who came out of there to meet with us. They told us that in their network of house churches inside Iran, that there were over 350 house churches in their network. This is Iran, and Iran may have the most oppressive government on the planet toward the gospel. And yet, inside that deep, dark persecution, the gospel flourishes. But that should not shock us, because if you study history, and you study the history of the gospel, the gospel always advances in a context of difficulty. It's those of us who live in comfort that struggle. It's those of us who have everything made that tend to get comfortable, and we let our guard down, don't we? Yes, we do. So, please pray for the people of Iran also. Ukraine. You obviously know what's going on there. Our churches have been very generous. Our churches have sent thousands and thousands and thousands of dollars in relief funds and different things to help the people of Ukraine. And so please keep praying for them. We have some faithful, faithful churches and brothers there and sisters who are serving the Lord in the middle of a lot of difficulty. But it's very important, isn't it? This geopolitical dynamic and reality. We do not trust in politics. We do not. We trust in our Lord who is sovereign over all things. But we do follow the geopolitical dynamic. Why? Because for us, a lot of times, it has much to do with the receptivity of the gospel in a certain place. And then it also has to do with missionary security and safety as well. So we follow those things quite closely. Well, hey, a couple of more things before the sermon this morning. Hey, I know that you are very aware of Brian and Pam Reisner's ministry in Romania. Praying for them today. You probably well know that they're in another transition now. And they were in Oradea to start their ministry. They went to Brasov to help start a new church. And now they're transitioning back to Oradea, more in the north, to start a new church. So we pray for them. We rejoice in the way that God is using them. And we certainly are thankful that Grace Baptist Church is a great partner with Brian and Pam Reisner and their kids and their ministry in Romania. One other story, and then I will get to the sermon. So something that we're very excited about, to give you an example of what's going on in BMA Global Missions. Do you know that worldwide, we have approximately 2,000 churches in our BMA family? Currently, we have over 400 missionaries serving in about 70 countries of the world. At this moment, today, our churches, just like yours, through BMA Global Missions, we are partnering today to plant over 380 new churches. That's going on right now around the world. And of course, we believe that the local church is both the source of missions. Why? Because we send missionaries, but it's the goal as well. We want to start more churches that will start more churches. But I want to give you one story, just one out of thousands, really. About 10 years ago, there was a young man by the name of Lawi from southern Sudan in Africa. And if you've studied anything about Sudan and southern Sudan, they've had extreme difficulties. But this young man left his country, went to Beirut, Lebanon, to study in the Baptist Seminary. Well, in that Baptist Seminary, we, the BMA, support some missionaries like Brother Charlie Costa and others who are very active in that seminary. Well, Lawi studied, finished his degree, then he went back to southern Sudan 10 years ago, and our churches began to support him as a missionary and a church planter. After 10 years, I'm very excited to tell you that they have planted 18 new churches in southern Sudan and northern Uganda. And so please pray for them. This is an example of things that are going on around the world. If the Lord willing, I am scheduled to go there in March, and we are going to establish a strategy for training their pastors at a deeper level. So please pray for them. Well, I could go on and on. I will not. But I hope some of these things just encourage your hearts today to know that, hey, God is doing amazing things around the world. He really is. And I know that sometimes you support missions and it becomes a very impersonal thing. We send our offerings. We can read on the website. Certainly encourage you to do that. We can read reports, but sometimes it just seems distant and impersonal. And so I pray that some of these stories have helped you this morning just to realize that God is doing great things. Micah chapter 5, that's where we're going to turn today. So a minor prophet in the Old Testament, and you can go Joel, Amos, Obadiah, Jonah, Micah. Or you can count seven from the end of the Old Testament and find it that way. All right? But this morning we're going to look at Micah chapter 5. We're going to read the first five verses, and the title of our sermon this morning is, O Little Town of Bethlehem. O Little Town of Bethlehem. We begin reading now in Micah chapter 5, beginning with verse 1. We'll read down through verse 5, but before we read, let's set the context. Here's what is happening. Micah is a prophet later in the existence of the kingdom of Judah. If you remember, Israel and Judah were divided after the reign of Solomon, but their spiritual lives were always marked by idolatry and disobedience to God. Well, nothing had changed here, really. And Micah, if you read the entire book, you will see that in the immediate, he was saying, hey, here are your three grave sins that you are repeating over and over and over, and God is displeased with you. Number one, they devalued life. Hey, they would sacrifice their children to the gods of paganism. They were mistreating fellow citizens and taking advantage of them and robbing from them. And then they were worshiping idols constantly. And God sends Micah, the messenger, the prophet, to say, this is unacceptable and you must do different. So this is the context. Micah comes on the scene. And really, if you read the book of Micah, he has a very distressing message of judgment, and it's not a very positive message. But in the middle of his message of judgment, there is the hope of all hopes. And that is the promise that one day in a little village 5 miles south of Jerusalem, there would be the miracle of all miracles when a baby would be born, and it wouldn't be just any baby, but it would be the incarnation when God himself became flesh. And he became flesh for a very specific purpose, for which we will look today. Let's begin reading now, Micah chapter 5, beginning with verse 1. Here's what Micah says. Now gather thyself in troops, O daughter of troops. He hath laid siege against us. They shall smite the judge of Israel with a rod upon the cheek. But thou, Bethlehem Ephratah, though thou be little among the thousands of Judah, yet out of thee shall he come forth unto me that is to be ruler in Israel, whose goings forth have been from of old, from everlasting. Therefore will he give them up until the time that she which travaileth hath brought forth. Then the remnant of his brethren shall return unto the children of Israel. And he shall stand and feed in the strength of the Lord, in the majesty of the name of the Lord his God. And they shall abide, for now shall he be great unto the ends of the earth. And this man shall be the peace, when the Assyrian shall come into our land, and when he shall tread in our palaces, then shall we raise against him 7 shepherds and 8 principal men. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, thank you so much today, God, that you are a great, awesome, merciful, and gracious God. And God, that you created us for yourself, and then sin came into that relationship and separated us from you. Thank you, God, that you are a holy God. And God, thank you so much that you've made it possible by promising that one day that deliverer, that Savior would arrive, and he did in Bethlehem 2,000 years ago. God, I pray today that the story of Christmas, that the story of Bethlehem, that the story of the birth of Jesus today would not be some tradition, some fable, some fairy tale, but God, that it would be the truth, the fact that you came to earth and all that that entails for us and all that it means. God, may our lives be transformed by the baby that was born, by the Savior that died on the cross and rose again, and may we today serve him with all that we have. God, I pray your rich blessings upon this congregation. I pray for them as they seek a pastor, God, that you would guide in all of that process and in those steps. Bless us now. May you be honored by all that we do and say. In Jesus' name, amen. So I don't know how many of you have ever been to the Three Ring Circus a three-ring circus. They're kind of going by the wayside today, right? Not many of those things left. Some of us who are a little older remember going to the circus when we were younger, and they called them the three-ring circus. Why? Because literally, they typically had three rings in there, and there were three different things going on all the time. It seemingly was very chaotic. In the first ring, you might have the elephants parading. In the second ring, maybe the lion tamer was working his magic. In the third ring, maybe the trapeze artists were flying over the crowd. And it certainly seemed like, wow, there's so much going on here that we can't even really understand all that's happening. Well, I want to say to you that the prophecy of Micah in Micah chapter 5 is a lot like a three-ring circus. And you got to view it that way, because there's a lot going on here. Once again, it seems like it's very confusing, but in reality, it's pretty clear. You just got to understand what's going on. And here are the three rings of the prophecy of Micah. In the first ring, in the immediate, Israel is sinning against God. And here's what's going to happen. The Babylonians under Nebuchadnezzar are going to come and take them captive. And that was a judgment for their sin. So that is what Micah is talking about in the first ring. In the second ring, Micah begins to talk about the first coming of Jesus when he was born in Bethlehem. And then in the third ring of the prophecy of Micah, he is talking about what's going to happen in the future. It's still future for us in 2022 when Jesus will come back. Not as a humble baby, but he will come back as the King of Kings. And so you got to think about Micah's prophecy kind of like the three-ring circus. Seems like there's a lot of confusion, but it's really very precise. It's really very precise. And so as we begin to look here, we're going to notice that. Bethlehem, what an incredibly small, insignificant place. And yet it has one of the most prominent places of all history. Oh, little town of Bethlehem, the place where the Savior was born. You know, it's very interesting. A couple of times in the New Testament where Bethlehem is mentioned. If you remember when the wise men got to Jerusalem, they began to ask, hey, we followed the star. Hey, where's the baby? And do you remember that the very religious leaders told them, well, the scripture says he was going to be born in Bethlehem. Now, the ironic thing about that is that those same priests who knew what the word of God said didn't believe it, because none of them went to worship Jesus, but yet they knew the scripture said that. Isn't that interesting? And there may be some of you here today that you know what the scripture says about Jesus Christ, and yet you do not have a personal relationship with Christ. Hey, all the knowledge about God could never be a substitute for knowing God. And the only way that we can know God today is through Jesus Christ. But also in John chapter 7, you remember Jesus was indeed born in Bethlehem, which was in the southern part in Judea. But the primary part of his ministry, the biggest part, was in the northern part in Galilee. And when he started that ministry in John chapter 7, some of the local people were discussing, this can't be the Messiah. Why not? Because the Messiah is not coming from Galilee. He's coming from Bethlehem, which they didn't realize they were both right and wrong, right? They were right that he did come from Bethlehem. They just didn't understand that he had moved up there where they were. And so the point being that the Bible says over and over and over again that this little bitty village of Bethlehem has a very prominent place in God's redemptive plan. It would be that place where the Savior would be born. Now, what do we notice here in Micah chapter 5? I want you to see today that Micah, who spoke 700 years before Jesus was born, I'm going to say that again. Micah, who delivered God's message 700 years before Jesus was born. I want you to notice that the exactness, the specificity, the detail, that Micah spoke about Jesus 700 years before he was born. Why did he do that, and how is that possible? Obviously, because his message was from God. Verse 1, "Now gather thyself in troops, O daughter of troops. He hath laid siege against us. They shall smite the judge of Israel with a rod upon the cheek." Verse 1 really doesn't have anything to do with verses 2 through 5. Verse 1 is back over there in ring number 1. Hey, Israel, you're sinning against God. There's going to be someone that's going to come and smite you. So that was in the immediate. And then what happens in verse 2? He says, "But thou." So "but thou" gives us a great transition, a great contrast. Hey, Israel in the immediate, Judah in the immediate, you're about to suffer the judgment of God. "But thou, Bethlehem Ephratah." Oh, little town of Bethlehem. We have a message of hope. We have a message of peace and joy and everything we talk about at Christmas because of what happened in Bethlehem. "But thou, Bethlehem Ephratah, though thou be little among the thousands of Judah, yet out of thee shall he come forth unto me, that is to be ruler in Israel, whose goings forth have been from of old, from everlasting." May I say to you today that it's an incredible prophecy in Micah chapter 5 verse 2 that 700 years before Jesus was born, that Micah declared he will be born in Bethlehem. That's amazing. I would say to you that the more amazing fact of Micah chapter 5 and verse 2 is not the geography of his birth, but it is indeed the nature of his being. And in that last part of verse 2, what does it say about Jesus, the Savior that would be born in Bethlehem? It says this. It says that he, what? His goings forth have been from of old, from everlasting. Micah, 700 years before Jesus was born, tells us not only where he would be born, but tells us that Jesus Christ has always existed. That Jesus Christ is eternal. His goings forth are from days old. He is from everlasting. And so the first thing that we see here that Micah tells us about this Savior that would be born in Bethlehem is he tells us about the Savior and his eternal existence. Jesus is no ordinary man. Jesus is no ordinary religious leader. Did you know that every world religion on the planet has some kind of founder, some kind of leader, whether that be Muhammad or somebody else? Hey, every single one of them is based on what? It's based on man's works. The only world religion that looks to God to help us is Christianity. Everybody else thinks they control their own salvation. Also, we know that every other world religion has a founder that you can walk to their grave and you can pay homage to them there and put flowers on their grave. You cannot put flowers on the grave of Jesus because he is not there. He is not there. And so today we know that those are very specific differences. But Jesus Christ is not an ordinary person. He had to be the God-man. He had to be that perfect sacrifice for sin. He was 100% God in the flesh, but he was 100% man as well. He was the only one that was worthy to be the sacrifice for our sin. Jesus' own testimony. Jesus himself said, "I am from all eternity and forever." One of my favorite passages in the Bible, John chapter 1. John said what? "In the beginning was the Word was with God, and the Word was God." Talking about Jesus Christ. He was in the beginning, he is God. John chapter 8, Jesus was having a discussion with the religious people. And the religious leaders, of course, as they always did, they were berating him, and they were trying to harass him, and all of that stuff. And they brought up Abraham, Father Abraham. And this is what Jesus said. He says, "Hey, Abraham rejoiced to see my day." They said, "What are you talking about? Abraham lived hundreds of years ago. You're not even 50 years old. How could Abraham rejoice to see your day? And here is one of the great self-declarations of Jesus about his eternality. He said, before Abraham was, I am. Wow. Jesus, just as Micah said, claimed not to be temporary like we are, not to have a specific beginning and end. Jesus has neither. Jesus is eternal. In Isaiah 7:14, Isaiah wrote 750 years before Jesus was born. Here's what he said. He said, therefore the Lord himself shall give you a sign. Behold, a virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and shall call his name Emmanuel. We know that Emmanuel means God with us. That was the great thing. God who had existed, the eternal Son of God, who had existed forever and from forever and to forever, he came here in the form of a baby in that little town of Bethlehem in order to be the perfect sacrifice for our sin. What an amazing story. What an amazing truth. Matthew chapter 1 and verse 18 says, now the birth of Jesus Christ was on the wise. When as his mother Mary was espoused to Joseph before they came together, she was found with child of the Holy Ghost. How could God, what was the mechanism that God used to send his son here to remain perfect? How did that work? Well, the Bible clearly tells us in both the Old and New Testament that Jesus Christ was born of a virgin. What does that mean? That means Mary, who was not perfect, was chosen as an instrument of God. And what does it say? It says that that child that was placed in her was placed in her by the Holy Spirit. She did not have relations with another, with a man, a human man. It was a miracle. And that is how we know that the Savior came. And the virgin birth is so vital to what we believe today. So that it's the only way that a perfect God could come in human form. And so the first thing Micah says to us, he says, Jesus has always existed. He is eternal. He is from everlasting. He is from everlasting. And then he tells us in verse 4, and he shall stand and feed in the strength of the Lord and the majesty of the name of the Lord his God. And they shall abide, for now shall he be great until the ends of the earth. So the Savior is eternal in his existence. The second thing Micah tells us about Christ is that the Savior is the eternal ruler. Hey, the kingdom is coming, and every kingdom has to have a king. And yes, it is true that Jesus came the first time as an humble baby. He grew up as a martyr and being crucified on the cross. His own disciples said, hey, Jesus, are you about to kick the Romans out of our country now and establish your kingdom? And Jesus said, that's not the kingdom I came to build my first time here. But his second time, that is yet future for us, when Jesus comes again, he will come as ruler, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And so there's that next ring. You know, in that first ring, you said, hey, Judah, you're sinning against God. You're going to go into judgment. In that second ring, it says, hey, one day a Savior will come. And he came in Bethlehem. That third ring is, hey, for us, it's still yet future. Could be today. Jesus is coming again, and he's going to come back as the ruler. That will have no comparison. It says, they shall abide, for now shall he be great unto the ends of the earth. Isaiah again, 750 years before Jesus was born. In chapter 9 and verse 6, he says, for unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. In Revelation chapter 19, the Bible says, and he was clothed with a vesture dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word of God. And the armies which were in heaven followed him upon white horses, clothed in fine linen, white and clean. This is that future. that future thing. And out of his mouth goeth the sharp sword, that with it he should smite the nations, and he shall rule them with a rod of iron. And he treadeth the winepress of the fierceness and wrath of Almighty God. And he hath on his vesture, on his clothes, and on his thigh a name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. That baby born in Bethlehem came as an humble baby the first time. He will come back in the future and he will be the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. He's always been that in nature. But when he returns to the earth the second time, he will be that in practice. He will be that. So Micah tells us that Jesus, this baby that would be born in Bethlehem, has always existed. He tells us that he will be the eternal king. And the last thing that we notice here is this, that Micah tells us that this Savior that would be born would be the giver of eternal life. Why did Jesus have to come? Why? Because we are sinners. God created us for himself, and then sin came into that relationship, and we can't do anything to fix that. We cannot pay the price for our sin. Only Christ has paid the price for our sin. It had to be a perfect sacrifice. Only the God-man, who is eternal, who is the ruler over all things forever, could be the Savior of the world. No mere man, not one of us. And he says that here when he talks about shepherding. And we know that Jesus is the shepherd of our souls. And we know that even during the Christmas story, the shepherds went with haste to worship the baby Jesus. And so this analogy and this idea of shepherding is big, and we understand it as connected to the person of Jesus Christ. We want to close the message this morning just by emphasizing the fact that Micah said, hey, he will shepherd our souls. He will be the Savior. He will be the one that pays the price for our sins. That's what's going to happen in that little town of Bethlehem. Did you know the Bible, among many other things, in our sin presents us as different things? Some of those things that describe us as sinners are prisoners. We are imprisoned by our sin. Debtors. We have a debt to pay for our sin that we could never pay. And so, prisoner, debtor, criminals, we are guilty. We are condemned by our sin and because of our sin. But Jesus Christ, the one born in Bethlehem, who is the Savior and the giver of eternal life. You know what the Bible says to us who are imprisoned by our sin? It says in Galatians 5:1, it says, stand fast therefore in the liberty, the freedom, wherewith Christ, in the freedom wherewith Christ has made us free, and be not entangled again with the yoke of bondage. And so the great news of the Savior that was born in Bethlehem today is that to all of us who are imprisoned by our sin, there is freedom. In big church words, we call that redemption. We have been redeemed. We have been freed. Romans 6:23 says, for the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. And so for all of us who are debtors, we have a debt that we could never pay. We know that, but Christ paid the debt. He paid the debt, and the gift of God is eternal life. What about all of us in our criminality, in our guilt, in our condemnation? The Bible says in Romans chapter 8 and verse 1, there is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. 700 years before Jesus was born, Micah painted a very clear picture of the Savior. He said that he has always existed. He is eternal. He said that he is the ruler of all. And one day he will come back to this earth and he will be the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And number three, he is the giver of eternal life now. And for all of us, for all of us who are imprisoned by sin, who have a debt because of our sin that we cannot pay, and that we are condemned because of our sin, the baby born in Bethlehem gives us freedom from that sin. He redeems us. He gives us the freedom, and he pays the debt for us. And he says to us, there is therefore now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. I pray today that we all recognize, like Micah did, with such great clarity, who was this baby born in Bethlehem? He is eternal God. He is the King of Kings. He's the giver of eternal life. That's exactly what Micah said. Who is Jesus to you today? Who is Jesus to you? Is Jesus your Lord and Savior? Is Jesus eternal God? Has Jesus given you eternal life? If not, our prayer is that you would put your faith and trust in Christ today. We're going to stand and we're going to sing as we conclude this service today. Whatever the Lord is leading you to do, would you respond to how the Holy Spirit is drawing you and how the Holy Spirit is leading you? What an awesome Savior we have. He is eternal. He is King of Kings. He's the giver of eternal life. Do you know that life?